Mixed martial arts has a reputation for being brash, gritty, and fierce. You could say the same about Dana White, one of the most important fixtures in the sport. White is the man at the helm of the Ultimate Fighting Championship. Like the UFC, White comes from humble beginnings, an amateur boxer from New England with a knack for business. In 2001, when many saw the UFC as a flailing promotion destined for failure, White saw an opportunity and convinced Lorenzo and Frank Fertitta to buy the company for a mere $2 million. Today, the UFC empire's worth is estimated at $1 billion, with MMA's top fighters, a popular reality show, and a fan base that stretches around the globe. The man responsible for it all is our guest this week on Fighting Words with Mike Straka. From HDNet, this is Fighting Words with Mike Straka. This week's guest, UFC President Dana White. Now your host, Mike Straka.
You know, when people hear the name Dana White, they automatically think of the brash executive synonymous with the UFC. But what is it about you that motivates you to become the leader of the fastest growing sport in the world?
You know, well, people think I'm brash on this and that. Listen, this is the fight game. This isn't Microsoft or, you know, McDonald's or some corporation like that. It's the fight game. And you know, it's blown out of proportion, too. You know, the whole bad guy image thing.
You're big on Twitter. I mean, you got to be kind of a nice guy to be a social networker, don't you think?
Well, you know what? To be honest with you, the whole social network thing and Twitter, I don't have the greatest relationship with the media all the time because I feel that I call the media out on a lot of things. You know, the whole internet has changed the world and the media. You know, anybody with a website now is a journalist. So I just don't play their games. And the thing that I love about Twitter and a lot of the social media is I can talk directly to the fans and cut out these middlemen. I can say exactly what I want to say the way that I want to say it without somebody else interpreting what I said.
Right, and to that end, your video blog is very popular on YouTube. And that's another tool you use to sort of call out the media. Most recently, Jake Rosin. Another time was Loretta Hunt. But you do go out and say what you want to say.
Right.
You're not afraid of controversy, are you?
No, really what I say shouldn't be controversial. Listen, this isn't 1986 anymore where the media can say whatever they want about somebody and there's no way for you to respond. You can't rebuttal, you can't respond. Those days are over. So when the media does stuff that I think is wrong or, you know, whether it's misquotes or misinformation or flat out lying, I'm going to call them out on it. And I don't see what's so controversial about
right.
that.
What do you think, when you make business decisions, who do you consult with? Do you have somebody that you consult with yourself and say, okay, here's what I have an idea for this. Is this the best route to this end?
Yeah, there's a lot of decisions I make on my own, or Frank Lorenzo and I get together as a team and make decisions. The greatest thing that I have is obviously, you know, I've been in the fight game a long time. I know this business better than anybody does. And having two really smart, really open-minded businessmen as my partner is huge. And I think that, you know, part of the reason that this thing has become so big is because of the friendship, the relationship, and the trust that Frank and Lorenzo I have with each other.
What do you say to critics of yours who say, okay, Dana was a lucky guy, he was friends with two rich guys, and that's why he is where he is today?
I would say, yeah, the timing and everything lined up perfectly. But what a lot of people don't realize, people think that, you know, Frank Lorenzo and I have been friends for the last, you know, 15, 20 years, hanging out every day. Lorenzo and I didn't see each other for over 10 years before we bumped back into each other at a wedding. And, you know, like I say, timing is everything. Plus, you know, anybody who knows anything about me knows that I've put the work and the dedication and the time into this thing. But, yeah, I've been very lucky. I wouldn't disagree with that, you know. I think that anybody who is willing to work as hard as I am and everything lined up the way that it lined up for me, listen, I could care less if people think I'm lucky. I feel that I've been very lucky, too.
Back in the day, and a lot of people don't know this, you were offered a job or had a position with the WFA.
Right.
Do you think that if Fertitta's didn't buy the UFC like you advised them to do, would MMA be where it is today?
I don't think so. No, because like I said, it was the combination between me and the Fertittas to make it what it is today. Listen, I knew the fight business, but the reality is the Fertittas are big businessmen. But, you know, back when we started the UFC, you know, I ran some gyms dealing with, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars. we deal with millions and billions of dollars now, you know, and there's no doubt that's the Fertitta's area. And they are aggressive, smart, big thinkers. And I knew the fight game. And like I said, this awesome relationship that we've had together is one of the big reasons that MMA is where it is today and why the UFC is where it is today.
You won MMA Leading Man of the Year award by Fighters Only magazine, and you said this award is really for Lorenzo. Why did you say that?
Because, you know, I won it last year. I was honored, you know, that I won that award last year. But, you know, you remember I made the announcement saying how big it was going to be. You know, I had a big announcement coming, how big it was going to be and what it meant for Lorenzo to come on board full-time with the UFC. And when you look at it from my point of view, what a lot of people don't realize is Station Casinos is the reason that the UFC exists today. These guys made a lot of money through Stations, and through Stations, they were able to fund the UFC, okay? Now, Stations was the big, the UFC was the redheaded stepchild of the Fertitta business family, okay? Everybody that worked with them and around them shunned this thing and said, you're gonna lose all your money, this is insane, you know, I don't know why you're doing this, but they believed in it and they believed in me. And when the day came that Lorenzo was actually gonna leave that business and come full-time with us, it was a big day for me. It meant a lot to me because, you know, I felt like, you know, I was very key in getting it to where it was for him to leave and come over and join us. And I knew what he was going to bring to the table when he came. And if you look at all the things that have happened in the last year since he came internationally, he's kicked some serious ass, you know. But, you know, he's not a guy who's out in front. He's not the guy out there beating his chest. He's got a different personality than me, and he deserved that award. That's his. He won it this year as far as I'm concerned. I'm honored, and I appreciate that the fans voted for me, but that's Lorenzo's award this year.
You guys lost a lot of money in your UK expansion. Obviously, it's worked out since then. But what did you think when you saw those columns saying UFC is crazy for trying to expand it internationally?
No, because I believed in it. I knew. Just like, no different than when we started here, you know, in 2001. I knew England made sense, and I knew that it would be big. And the reason that we got crushed over there is because I spent so much money. I went over there guns a-blazing, especially with the marketing. When we put on that fight in London, I don't care if you lived in some small cow town, you knew the UFC was coming to England. That's how big I went on the marketing. You know, when you look back, you're like, God, we spent this much money, we lost this much money. But you never know. Had I not done that, would it be where it is today? Would it have grown throughout Europe the way that it has? Who knows? You know, now that everything has worked out, you don't know if it was the right answer or the wrong answer.
All right, so you grew up with a single mom. You dropped out of college. You did various jobs. Were even a bellhop in Boston. Do you think that your background makes it easier for you to deal with people on all levels? I mean, I'm talking moguls, people who run media conglomerates, to the fans that you're giving tickets away to.
I don't know if it makes it any easier or harder. I mean, I am who I am, and I treat everybody the same, whether you're a huge media conglomerate or you're just one of the fans. So everybody's the same to me, and I treat everybody exactly the same. So I don't know. But I've always, you know, it might be funny to some of the people watching, but, you know, I've been a people person my whole life, and I deal well with people. Or if you choose not to deal with me, then I don't deal well with you, you know. But either way, I know how to deal with people.
Do you think somebody else could run the UFC and bring it to where it is other than you?
You mean when we started this thing, could somebody else have done this? Probably, who knows? I don't know the answer to that. You know, I know there's a lot of things that I did, and Lorenzo says it all the time, that a regular guy wouldn't have done. You know, some moves that I made and a lot of decisions that I made that somebody else probably wouldn't have done. But I wouldn't be cocky enough to sit here and say somebody else couldn't have done it.
What do you think your greatest accomplishment is?
My greatest accomplishment?
Inside or outside the octagon?
My kids. You know, I think that, you know, I love what I do. I get up every day and can't wait to get into work, can't wait to win, can't wait to keep growing this thing. But, you know, at the end of the day, it's all about my kids. I love spending time with my kids and hanging out with them. And, you know, as much as I travel and as hard as I work, I try to always make sure that I can get as much time in with them as I can.
Do you think in your position it's easier or harder to please your kids?
No, my kids are pretty good kids. They're pretty easy to please. You know, they have lots of things and they get to do lots of things, but I make sure that they appreciate it and try to help them understand that, you know, I didn't grow up like this. You know, I didn't have birthday parties like this, and I didn't live in a house like this, and I didn't wear clothes like this. So I try to, you know, try to keep them grounded. You know, the one thing to me is, you know, I'm not pushing my kids and saying they have to be doctors or lawyers or go to college or any of this stuff. I want my kids to be just like me. I want my kids to be happy. I want them to get up every day and love going to work, because I think there's so many people out there that get up every day and are miserable going to these jobs that they hate, and that's what I don't want for my kids. Two things I don't want is that, and I want to make sure that I keep my kids away from drugs. If I can do those two things, I did it. I was a good dad.
Coming up next on Fighting Words with Mike Straka.
There was a time when you said to the Fertitta brothers, it's time to look for a buyer for this thing. During that time, did you ever think to yourself, I'm in over my head?
That's coming up next on Fighting Words. Welcome back to Fighting Words with Mike Straka. This week's guest, UFC President Dana White.
You're on record as saying you're the biggest MMA fan on the planet.
Right.
What kind of background did you have that made you such a fight fan?
You know what, I don't know. I had uncles that used to love boxing, and they used to watch all the big fights on ABC's Wide World of Sports, and ever since I was a little kid, I just fell in love with fighting, you know, and really all types of fighting. You know, boxing was my favorite when I was growing up, but I used to love Bruce Lee movies, Chuck Norris movies, you know. I was always into fighting, period.
When you're walking around every single day with the toughest guys on the planet, do you ever feel insecure?
No, not at all. I think that, you know, I've been around fighters my whole life, and I understand them. I know how they're built. I know, you know, I know what motivates them. I know what makes them tick. I know who is and who isn't. So, no, and I have pretty good relationship with most of the guys. You know, when you're the guy that makes decisions in people's lives, you're never going to be the most popular guy around. But, you know, I have a good relationship with most of the guys that I'm interested in having a good relationship with.
A lot of people will say, and I wouldn't argue, that you're the most powerful man in MMA. How do you define power?
You know, I've been, you know, Randy Couture, when we were sideways, accused me of having a big stick and using it, you know. I don't remember exactly how he said it, but it was basically saying, you know, I'm not afraid to use this thing on people, which isn't true. I think if you're fair with me, I'm very fair with you. I don't run around, you know, threatening people or threatening to destroy people or trying to hurt people. As long as you do fair, upfront business with me, man, I'm the best friend you'll ever have. But if you don't and you want to go the other way, I like to win, so I can also be your worst enemy.
How hard is it to sanction a sport around the country and around the world?
It was harder, you know, 7-8 years ago. Now we've got 10 years of success, 10 years of safety. You know, there's no reason this shouldn't be sanctioned everywhere right now, today. But I accept the fact that this is going to be, you know, a process where we're going to have to go out and educate people. You know, I accept that and I get it. But what's going to happen is, when I have my 10-year plan and I talk about 10 years from now and everybody thinks I'm nuts, what you got to realize is for about 15 years now, lots of people have been into this sport and are educated on it and understand it. Over the last 9, we've educated a lot more throughout the world. The next 10 are going to be much easier. Plus, all these kids that have been growing up over the last, you know, it'll be 25 years when we get through the next 10. They grew up with the UFC.
Right.
Nobody's going to be terrified of this thing, and because it's this thing we're uneducated about and we don't know about. Kids that grow up watching it, understand it, are going to get it, and they're going to start taking over most of these key jobs, the guys who are my age now and younger. So it's, trust me, the next 10 years, when I say this thing, people aren't looking at the big picture, and people aren't deep into this thing like I am. They don't get it.
What's your biggest regret, if you have any?
I don't really have any regrets. I really don't. You know, I kind of live my life that way. You know, last thing I want to be doing is laying on my deathbed going, I wish I would have, or I wish I didn't. You know, I pretty much say what I want to say, do what I want to do, and I don't regret anything.
Were you always like that, though? I mean, now that you have this position and you're world famous and you're a celebrity in your own right, you pretty much can say whatever the hell you want to say, but were you like that coming up?
I was doing it, you know, I've been doing it for the last 10 years. You know, I got into this thing and I did it the way that I wanted to do it. Nobody held me back. Nobody, you know, the Fertittas never said, don't do it this way, don't say that, don't do this. They let me run this thing the way that I wanted to. Let me be me. And, you know, no, I have no regrets.
How have you changed in the last 10 years?
I've mellowed out a lot. I have, man. I've mellowed out a lot. You take my original crew that worked for me at the UFC, and they'll tell you I'm a million times more mellow than I used to be. I used to be an animal, man, and I used to be, you know, I had to let go of a lot of things as the company got bigger. I had to. You couldn't sharpen a pencil in the UFC offices without asking me first back in the old days. Nothing happened, nothing went out the door, nothing, you know, no phone call was made without talking to me first. Now there's shit going on I don't even know about, you know what I mean, on a daily basis.
I've been covering the sport for a long time, and since Azufa took over UFC, and I've seen a lot of the same people in your organization since that time. What does loyalty mean to you?
It means everything to me. You know, I believe that we all have to pick a team and go with it, man. You know, these people that hop from place to place looking for more money or looking for this or looking for that. I sat down with a group of fighters and a group of employees, and I talked to everybody one-on-one and said, here's my vision. Here's where I want to take this. Are you with me or are you not with me? And the people that were still are, and I guarantee you they don't regret a minute of it, they've made a lot of money, you know, and they get to travel the world and have fun. And that group of fighters that were loyal to me, I've been very loyal to, you know. There's a story about me and Matt Hughes didn't get along too well in the beginning. You know, I always got this weird vibe from him. You know, he was always, I don't know, I can't really explain it or put my finger on it, but one day we were down promoting his fight in Miami when he fought Sean Sherk, and I grabbed him and said, let's go for a walk. And we walked down, you know, down the street in Miami and talked, and I basically gave him that talk. Since that night, Matt Hughes and I have been, you know, I trust him, he trusts me, and I've done everything I ever said I would do, and he's done everything he ever said he would do, you know. And there were times when, back in the crazy days, when everybody was coming at us and Hughes was the top guy in the world, and Hughes would be on his last fight of his deal and would fight it, and I wouldn't sweat it one bit, like not worried that Matt wouldn't re-sign with us. And, you know, Matt never sweated me stepping up to the plate and doing what I should have done without him going out and getting five or six different bids on his services.
There was a time when, and it's well documented, that you said to the Vertitta brothers, it's time to look for a buyer for this thing. And they said, let's stick with it. And you made The Ultimate Fighter, and the rest is history. During that time, did you ever like think to yourself, I'm in over my head?
No, I never thought I was in over my head, but I thought it was over. You know, when Lorenzo made that call and said, I can't keep pumping this money into this thing, you know, get out in the streets and see what you can get for it. You know, that day I was making calls all day, finding out how much we could sell it for. And by the end of the night, it was anywhere between 4 to 6 million. And I called him and gave him the number. And I said, all right, I'll call you in the morning. And he called me back the next day and said, fuck it, let's keep going. You know, I never said, I'm in over my head. I was just like, that was a close one. This thing's about to be over. You know, I was already working as hard as somebody could work, but I said, I got to step it up even more and put this thing into overtime.
You credit a lot of the UFC success with Forrest Griffin versus Stephen Bonner, that finale. Do those guys have a permanent life in the UFC?
Yep. Yep, Stephen Bonner and Forrest Griffin are with me, you know, like my kids. They're with me forever, you know? And like I say, it's more than just, that's the other thing too. You know, I go out and put on all the bells and whistles and do all the things that need to be done. And we have a whole staff out there that goes out and does all the groundwork. But at the end of the day, it's our partners, the fighters, who step in there and make everything happen. And the thing about our guys is, they always deliver, man.
What's more fun to do, making somebody's dreams come true or crushing that person's dreams?
No, I'm a dream maker, man. I love it. I love taking people in and turning people into stars and changing people's lives. And even with the fans, you know, I get tons of emails and, you know, these are some hard times. People are in hard times right now. And I love doing fun, exciting things that, you know, makes people either happy at the moment or changes people's lives. You know, crushing isn't fun, but I will crush too if you put me in that position.
Do you think we're going to see UFC on network television, and do you even need network television?
Yeah, I think it's eventually going to happen. Do we need it? No, but if we get it, I think it takes things to a different level. But as you can tell, I'm in no rush. You know, when the right deal is there, I'm listen, this company's not going to be disrespected anymore. We're not going to just jump on some goofy television deal just because we, you know, some big network thinks we need them, because we don't. And we're going to take our time and do this thing the right way. Every guy that you've seen, you know, you've seen all these, you know, small, worthless promotions get a network deal before we do. And what did it do to them? It destroyed them.
You've worked so hard, and everybody knows how hard you work. And UFC 100 was the culmination of that work. How successful was UFC 100? And how pissed were you at Brock Lesnar?
UFC 100 was bigger than I thought it would be. It kind of took on a life of its own. It was crazy how this thing just, you know, by UFC 92, people were talking to me about 100. And, you know, I'm focused on 92 and 93, not 100. It was just another show for me, but it ended up being so big, but everything went by so fast, I didn't really have time to kick back and enjoy it and take it all in. But the aftermath of it was amazing. And that night, I was, it's not that I was so pissed at Brock, I was blown away, I was in shock, and I couldn't understand why he would do that to me.
Was it a kick in the teeth, though, to you?
No, when it was all said and done, I mean, Brock's crazy. You know what I mean? He's a big madman. He's a big mountain man madman. That's what he is. And he's a passionate guy, too. He loves to compete, and he got out there and he got crazy. You know, he beat Frank Mir. He wanted that thing so bad. And he went crazy after. And I tell guys all the time, if you swear on TV, you're really going to stick it to me, because it's like it's the worst thing you can do. Mm-hmm. But it's going to happen sometimes, you know? And it's not like these guys are going out to directly try to hurt me. And I don't think Brock was either. Brock just went a little crazy, and it happens sometimes.
Let's talk about, you're driving in your Ferrari down the strip. What's your favorite CD to pop in?
I'm a big Rage Against the Machine fan. Rage.
Favorite video games?
I was never really, I liked going to the arcade and playing games when I was younger, but I've never really been a big video game guy. I always felt like video games were a waste of time, and there was so many things you, I remember the first time that I sat down when I was like 18 years old, and the new boxing game had just came out on Sega or something, where Mike Tyson could fight Jack Dempsey, and all these different boxers could box, and you know, I sat there and I played it all day. And then when I got done, it was, I just, the whole day was gone. I said, I just wasted an entire day of my life. I didn't win anything. I didn't receive anything. You know, nothing happened to me. This is horrible. I didn't like it. I packed the game up, sent it to my little cousins, and never played video games again.
All right, I'm going to throw out some names. Just let me know what you think of these people. Warren Buffett.
He's a stud. I mean, I like these guys, these big business guys that have been around forever and are still that aggressive and get up every day. Guys like Buffett, Kirk Kerkorian, you know, guys like that I really respect and look up to.
How about Michael Milken?
Yeah, I mean, any of these guys that have been around for years and continue to get up and kick ass every day, because I got to tell you, man, I'm still a young guy. I just turned 40, you know, and I love what I do. But man, to get up every day and keep doing it, some of these guys are in their 80s.
Do you ever see yourself retiring?
Yeah, I could see myself retiring. People all tell me no. There's no way you could do it. There's no way. But yeah, I could see me doing it. Trust me.
You would hand the reins over of UFC one day to somebody else?
Yeah, I could do it. Believe me, I know what my job is over the next 10 years. I know what my job is. And I know what I have to accomplish and what I have to get done. Everybody thinks I can't do it, meaning couldn't step away, couldn't retire. Once I set my mind to do something, trust me, I'll figure out something else to do.
Dana, thank you so much for joining us on the show.
My pleasure. Thank
you. Really appreciate it. And looking forward to the next decade and see what you're going to bring the sport to.
I'm going to bring everything that I said I'm going to bring over the next 10 years.
Dana White.
This has been an exclusive presentation of HDNet.